Well, we need to become like Jesus for life to the full. The more we become like Jesus, the more we live life to the full. But primarily the purpose is to glorify him, to give him praise in this earth, but also to be fruitful for him. So, you know, we're meant to, that's what I think, that, you know, and I think so much of our discipleship needs to happen on the front foot of mission. You know, we need to release people into mission and take risks with them, because as they become more like Christ, they become ever more effective. But then as they get more and more engaged in mission, they become more like Christ and become more effective. So there's that beautiful thing going on. So, you know, there's a real sense that as we become more like Jesus, we'll influence more people, because we're all Jesus has got. All Jesus has got is this ragbag bunch called the church, but he believes in it. And I remember I was at we have these prayer days once a month where we down tools and pray and seek God. And I was like, going, oh God, I just can't stand your church. It drives me crazy. It does such a rubbish job of discipling all these people who are coming to Christ, the prisons and on the margins. And I don't know, I didn't hear an audible voice of God, but I had this little sense of, don't you dare diss my bride. You know, the church is all I've got. I love her, you love her.
The first purpose is obviously that we should fulfill God's purpose. That's what God wants. And so we should be seeking to want what he does. But another very important purpose of growing more like Jesus is that it makes the gospel believable. If we who call ourselves followers of Jesus don't look anything like Jesus, why should anybody believe us? Why should they listen to us? So I think for the witness to the gospel, for our whole authenticity and credibility in the world, Christians need to be Jesus people.
The overall purpose seems to me to be to bring glory to God. There are some other benefits, but the overall purpose, I think, is to bring glory to God. That is that as we become more like his son, he's pleased. He gets pleasure from that. He doesn't love us anymore or any less, but he's pleased by that. And so, actually, the power of the gospel is made manifest in us. As we change, become more like him, other people see, my goodness, isn't that extraordinary? You know, we live to the glory of God. We walk by faith to the glory of God, and he wants to work in us that his glory might be manifest. And somebody says, I knew Mark when he was 22. You won't believe how little he's changed. No, what about since it, you know, but there is that. And we see that in people who become Christians, and we see that in Christians over time. And we go, wow, praise God. I mean, they were broken. They're healed. They were always angry. Now they seem terribly kind. They couldn't stand foreigners. Now, you know, now they have a multicultural community living in their house, whatever it might be. And so that brings glory to God. It's a testimony of the power of the gospel. So that's a purpose. But there are so many benefits. One of God's purposes is because he wants us to be free. For freedom, Christ has set us free. And as we grow more like his son, we are freer to be the people he wants us to be. So there's the benefit to us, and there's the glory it brings to him. And then I think also another reason he wants us to become Christ-like is because it's good for other people. Because the more like his son I am, the more likely I am to love other people. And God wants us to love other people the way he loves them. So I'm more likely to do that if I'm more like him. So there's, yeah.
Well, becoming like Christ is what we are created for. That's the whole purpose of life, in a way, is that we should be, I think the way that the Apostle Paul puts it is that we should be conformed to the likeness of his son. That is the whole purpose. Jesus died for us in order that we should be conformed to his likeness. This is the purpose of life, is to know Christ and to become like Christ. And we do it as we gaze into Christ, as we look into him, then we are transformed into his image by the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit who changes us. It's the Holy Spirit who produces the fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness. All these things come from the Holy Spirit who lives within us. This is how Jesus lives within us, is by the Spirit. It's the Spirit of Christ within us who transforms us into the likeness of Christ.
Well, fundamental to our calling as human beings is that we were made in the image of God. In other words, through everything that we do, however we interact with other people, whatever we think, whatever we say, we're supposed to be imaging the very character of God to our world. And interestingly, Jesus is described as the image of the invisible God. So he is the perfect example of what it means to be human. And so it is as we follow in the footsteps of Jesus that we actually fulfill our calling, what we were created to do in the first place. So as we image Christ, therefore we image God, we complete our fundamental calling as human beings.
Love, joy, and peace. The first three on Paul's list of the fruit of the Holy Spirit sound very spiritual. They're just the kind of things that good Christians ought to have and to show. But when we come to patience, we're coming to something which has to do more with that area of life between Monday and Saturday and what we're like to live with in our places of work or our homes, or indeed in places where we take our leisure and play. Patience as a fruit of the Holy Spirit means, on the one hand, the ability to endure for a long time the kind of opposition and suffering that may come our way, and on the other hand, the ability to put up with the weaknesses and foibles of others, including other believers. But before we go on thinking about patience as a quality that we should show, let's first of all think about patience as a quality of God. Now, maybe you wouldn't think of the patience of God as particularly a feature of the Old Testament. Usually the so-called God of the Old Testament is thought of as being always angry or suddenly angry. And certainly there are stories in the Old Testament where God's anger does break forth, and indeed where it is justified. The very first description that God gives of himself in Exodus 34, verse 6, is when he said to Moses that his name was the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger and abounding in love. Slow to anger is of the character of God. And when you look at the history of the Old Testament, it's the long story of God's patience over many centuries and generations with Israel. Isaiah told Israel how God had borne their sins like a burden that he had to carry. In fact, he said that he had carried Israel themselves from the cradle to the grave. And actually, the word in the Old Testament that's usually translated to forgive is actually to bear or to carry. That's to say, when God forgives, it's because he chooses to bear our sins himself, which, of course, is exactly what Jesus did on the cross. So the Old Testament then shows God's incredible patience, even though it was combined with necessary acts of judgment. And when the New Testament goes on to speak about the patience of Jesus, as he bore the violence and the cruelty and the injustice of the cross, it also makes that example of Jesus an example for how we should exercise patience. Here's what Peter says about the suffering and patience of Jesus in 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 21 to 24. He says, "Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross." That's the patience of Jesus that Peter said should be an example and a model to us. So let's come back then to the two senses of this word patience when we're thinking about it in terms of our Christian living. First of all, there's the patience of endurance of suffering. It's very clear in the Bible that God's people will suffer because of the hostility and enmity of those who are enemies of God and of God's people. And so Christ's example that I've just quoted is crucial for us, not just the fact that he suffered, but how he endured it. So listen to what Peter has to say again. This is in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12. He says to Christians, "Dear friends, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that has come on you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you, but rejoice inasmuch as you participate in the sufferings of Christ." So those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good. So Peter's message basically is that when Christians suffer, there should be no surprise, no retaliation, but also no quitting. Go on doing good. Well, we know that millions of our Christian sisters and brothers all around the world know exactly what this means. They are suffering hatred, discrimination, imprisonment, and indeed often killing and martyrdom because of their faith in Jesus. And we need to pray for them and seek to encourage them. And we also need to be prepared for the fact that if such suffering should come our way through hostility to the gospel from whatever source, that we need to be willing to endure it, because that's what patience includes. But secondly, of course, we also need to remember that patience means forbearance with others. That is, when you choose to bear with other people rather than firing them off when they annoy you, or even worse. It means that you choose to forgive somebody rather than hold a grudge. It means that you choose to overlook something that was hurtful or unkind rather than picking a fight and getting even. And that kind of patience, it seems to me, seems to be needed more and more within the Christian community around the world, especially perhaps among Christian leaders and between Christian denominations and organizations. I don't know if you know the silly little poem that goes like this, that to dwell in love with saints above, ah, that will be glory. But to dwell below with saints we know, that's a different story. Because it can be hard, it can be difficult to have the patience to put up with other Christians, and indeed, not to mention the patience that they need sometimes to put up with us. But that's what the Bible demands, that's what we're called for, even when we're misunderstood, when we're misinterpreted, and when we're treated unfairly. That's when patience is tested, that's when it really counts. There's a line of that lovely hymn, "There is a green hill far away," which goes, "He died that we might be forgiven." Yes, that's true. But also we can say, "He died that we might be forgivers."